sitting as solicitor.
Okay, thank you. We have two cases tonight to hear. The first matter before us is 33 North 10th Street. It's appeal 2016-35. The applicant's present. Okay, if you'd come up here, please.
Yes.
You'd be seated. Okay. Now, why don't you move over here just a
sure.
little closer to the stenographer, then she can hear. Okay. Would you swear on our zoning officer, please?
Raise your right hand and swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help you God.
I do.
Okay, Mr. Knight?
Or you have to ask me if notice has been given.
Oh, yeah, I've noticed the appeal been given.
It has.
Okay. I'd like to introduce the exhibits for the record. Exhibit 1 will be the notice. Exhibit 2 will be the proof of publication. Exhibit 3 will be the proof of service. Exhibit 4 will be the application and all of its attachments. Exhibit 5 will be the zoning ordinance as amended. Exhibit 6 will be any comments from the zoning officer, planning commission, or borough council. And Exhibit 7 will be an attendance sheet, if there is one. I'm not sure if you guys do attend. Okay. So then we'll scratch Exhibit 7.
Okay. Are both you gentlemen going to testify tonight?
Yes.
Okay. Would you swear in our
right
applicant?
Hands, please. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help God?
Yes, I do.
Okay. Joshua Bednar?
Yes.
That's you? Okay. And your name, sir?
Richard Bednar.
Okay. And so we have one rule. We can't talk at the same time. We have to write everything down.
Okay. All right, gentlemen, we can do this one of two ways. Our solicitor can take you through a series of questions, and that doesn't preclude you from adding anything that you would want. We may have additional questions, or you can present the case yourself, and then we'll ask whatever questions we feel we need to fill in. So whatever you gentlemen feel comfortable doing.
All right, I'll start. We're pretty much just looking to properly go through the zoning procedures and make sure that we have a proper zoning permit, and then we'll obtain the occupancy permit after once we get this decision rendered from you guys next month. Looking to open a small used car dealership within the state requirements. We've notified or contacted Pennsylvania Independent Auto Dealers Association trade group out of Harrisburg. They are a trade group that guides new dealerships and independent auto dealerships in Pennsylvania through the proper procedure from opening or operating an existing dealership. So this is always something I've been interested in, so I contacted them and going through the proper channels to make everything 100% with the city.
Okay. What kind of vehicles are you going to sell here? Cars, trucks, light trucks, that kind of
thing?
Yeah,
light trucks, and we're going to target two niches, Jeep Wranglers and like Toyota Tundras, Dodge, Chevy, Ford.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like off-road type.
Yeah, a little bit bigger, okay. With bigger tires and stuff.
All right. Gentlemen, any of you have any questions?
What's your experience? Why you got to get into this? Do you have any other dealerships? Or?
No, just I have a really passion for cars and trucks, motorcycles, boats, pretty much anything with a motor. So it's something I've been interested in. Sold a bunch of cars, bought a bunch of cars so far. But the state, however, does have a requirement that you cannot sell more than 7 vehicles as a person per year. So it's kind of like the next step, next like rational step for me.
Okay. Now, as you know, this is a sort of busy little city street, small street. It's a one-way
sure.
Street. The concern I would have would be I noticed that you made an indication about not doing any repairs, but from time to time, cars maybe need the battery charged. Something does go wrong with it. So, what kind of assurances do you have that you won't be taking up any off-street parking, that kind of thing?
Well, the state has a requirement. There's a requirement for 5 sale spots for vehicles to be sold, and then there's also a minimum requirement for cars for customer parking only. It's 4 spots, one of which is designated for a handicap accessible space. So we're going to go through all the state, you know, requirements, make sure this is, you know, up to snuff, because
we have more than five parking spaces on that lot. We're just going to designate five for the placement of the vehicles for sale. And then we also have a garage attached to that, that if we need to pull a vehicle in there, like you said, to charge a battery or something, that it won't be on the street to.
That was my concern, because every once in a while we do things similar to this. It was like a little garage, mm-hmm. and we had to send the enforcement people out because it turned out to be out front of place, a junkyard, and we certainly, you know, don't want to have anything like that. So.
Yeah, no, we're trying to make improvements to this neighborhood. I actually personally live at the second floor of this property.
I saw that.
So I have a vested interest, you know, in the success of this block and my business. I don't know if there was before and after pictures attached to that, but we've transformed this property from the day we bought it 3 years ago. You know, it looks a lot better. The block's doing a lot better. I don't think there's going to be an impact. I don't think we're going to have a greater impact. If anything, I think it's going to be less because we currently rent those spaces.
Okay.
So I don't think that the amount of traffic coming in and out of that parking lot is going to be increased by anything. I think if anything, it might be reduced because I'll have less people coming and going throughout the day.
How many vehicles can you get in this lot at one time for sale?
Well, I need a minimum five spaces for state licensure.
Okay.
There is, I believe, what was it, 13 and four, so 17 spaces total. Yeah.
And can you tell me in relation, where is this picture taken relative to looking straight back? Where is this?
What other pictures do you have there?
That's at the end of the,
yeah.
End of the parking lot.
One at a time, I need to hear you.
Show me where that is.
Right here. That vehicle.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, that's just against the garage okay. here. Looking in from the street, that's right here.
Okay. And you say you live, where do you live?
On the second floor of the apartment.
Where?
Right here.
This building.
Mm-hmm.
This is one building
no,
here.
This is one building.
Here.
No, this is 31 North 10th.
Oh.
You can see
the door's over here.
Yeah.
This is one building. And
this
is adjacent to the lot?
Correct. It's next to the lot.
Next to the lot.
Yep.
And you live on the second floor?
Second or third floor, correct.
Okay. You rent the first floor then?
Yeah.
All right.
There's no alley back there.
No, this property is actually very unique. It starts on 10th Street and goes to Mulberry Street. I have a garage there. It's roughly 7,000 square feet. That's where we're going to put the office, and then the rest will be personal storage.
But you can't go through to Mulberry.
Oh, yeah, you can, but only
how do you
I can.
Go through to Mulberry?
You just open this garage door right here.
Okay.
Yeah. Pull right through.
All right.
You have to drive through the garage.
Yeah.
That's
right.
Wait.
I think it's long enough in the summer. I can take my boat in one end and take it out the other end.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
If the zoning office made certain recommendations for you, certain things that you had to do in addition to some of the things we talked about, would you be amenable to that?
Well, what do you have in mind?
Well, I think one of the things is you would need to go through the building trades and fire permit process. Have a parking lot lighting plan. Your parking lot plan needs to be dimensioned out. A camera and security system should be installed. And you need to supply signed drawings and specifications in compliance with the city ordinance. And we would help you with that. All the vehicles have to be registered. They can be used for car sales only, no repairs. And no vehicles may be stored on the lot that are in disrepair, and no vehicle parts may be stored on the lot. We've had a lot of that kind of stuff going on in the city where people said they're going to do a used car lot, and the next thing you know, like you heard previously, turns out to be a junkyard or a gypsy garage that they're doing that kind of thing. So these are the things that, you know, we would ask if we give you approval, you know, would you be amenable to dealing with those things? And our zoning officer would work with you on that.
I mean,
it's your call?
Yeah, I mean, you guys have been very easy to work with so far, so.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm not looking to sell parts or anything like that. I'm looking to, you know, sell nice vehicles and make some money.
Okay.
Have you seen this list that I'm looking at now, or is this the first time that you've seen this? It's basically what Mr.
Those aren't provided to you.
No. Oh, they're not?
No. So if you're, amenable to those types of things, we will take that under consideration when we, when we vote on this matter.
Yeah, I'm just trying to get my ducks in a row and, get all the permits required.
Yeah, I have no questions.
I have another question. The, as Mr. Fox did, what building is that sign affixed to, the sign that says parking spaces for rent?
That's my building, 33 North 10th Street.
That's 33. You had mentioned 31 came up.
Oh, we own the one next door to that, though.
And that's going in.
That's another rental property.
Okay.
It's just, there's three buildings there. It's 33, 31, 29. We own 33 and 31.
So this sign refers to your lot. Are you going to be renting spaces, too, in addition to your business?
If anything, the spaces may go. The rental spaces may go to augment the business.
We have a permit to rent the parking spaces now. So
right.
We're going to
reduce. Will that conflict with the number of spaces that you're indicating to us that you're going to be utilizing for the auto business?
No, they will be removed from the rental and put on for the automobile dealership. So the five spaces we're going to use for the car sales will be removed from the five we rent.
Okay. And you
it'll
spell
be the first five closest to the street.
You spell that out in your
yes.
your plan here? I want to make sure I read that.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you.
Any other questions from anybody up here? Anybody in the audience have any questions of this applicant? I know some of you just came in. We're dealing with 33 North 10th Street. All right, seeing none. Anybody want to testify for the granting of the application? Seeing none. Anybody want to testify against? Seeing none. So, gentlemen, that concludes your hearing, and we'll make a decision at next month's meeting. You don't have to be here. It will be mailed to you, but you're welcome to attend.
Okay, very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time, guys.
Thank you.
Okay. Now, we had the matter of 208 Chestnut Street, and that has been continued to the December 14th regular meeting. So 208 Chestnut Street is on for next month's meeting. That involved Remcom Plastics, Inc. All right. So our last hearing is 428 West Windsor Street. It's appeal 2016-37. Are the applicants here?
They are.
Okay. You'd come forward, please. Going to swear in our zoning officer a while?
I do.
Okay, has notice for this appeal been given?
It has.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Knight?
Okay, I'd like to introduce the exhibits for the record. Exhibit 1 is the notice. Exhibit 2 is the proof of publication. Exhibit 3 is the proof of service. Exhibit 4 is the application and all of its attachments. Exhibit 5 is the zoning ordinance as amended. And Exhibit 6 will be any comments from the zoning officer, planning commission, or borough council.
Okay, thank you. I'm assuming you're counsel.
I am.
So if you enter your appearance, and then we'll swear in the applicant.
My name is Michael Mansour. I'm an attorney at Kozlov Stout. I'm here on behalf of the applicant, Nelson Soto.
Okay, thank you. You want to swear in, Mr. Soto? Is he going to be testifying?
Yes, he is.
Okay.
Raise your right hand, please. Sorry. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth now,
God? I do.
It'll be good if I can see you.
He can sit. We can switch.
Okay. Just sit back a little.
Then I can sure.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
You
don't
have to sit back
though. Whenever you're ready, you can begin.
Just to give the board a little bit of background, Mr. Soto will be testifying later about his involvement with rental property in the city of Reading. However, Mr. Soto is an established rental landlord in the city of Reading, and came to purchase from Robert Rohrbach, who was here, back there, a property at 428 West Windsor Street in Reading, Pennsylvania. Now, to the extent the board requires it, the testimony will show that Mr. Rohrbach represented to Mr. Soto that this property was zoned for a rental, for a two-unit rental. And I believe you have in front of you the pictures. I see the member of the board across from me has the pictures of the building as well as the interior of the building that show the condition of the building when Mr. Soto purchased it. With a special interest, and I think this is in, as part of four, if I can hold this up, this is a two mailbox setting for the property, indicating that it has two residents. You'll also note that these boxes are of roughly the same vintage, so they're placed at about the same time, same amount of wear and tear. Turn the page.
They might be set up a little differently.
Well, I'm going to show them to them.
Mm-hmm.
And you can pass these around. Here we have apartment 1 meter, apartment 2 meter, and then over here, not shown, but you can see there are three, is the owner's meter. So there are two separate meters. Here we have electrical inspection sticker for existing panels. Shows the age of it. This was not a recent renovation by Mr. Soto. And finally, on this page, two gas meter base hookups. This place has mechanicals and hookups for two residential rental units. I'll be passing this around as well. You'll see the renovations that Mr. Soto is conducting on the property indicate that the property has two units, both of which are roughly the same vintage, all of which sustains and bolsters Mr. Soto's claim that he had reasonable basis to believe that what he was purchasing was a two-unit rental unit. Now, so that's where we have it. I'll have copies.
We have those in our packet. Thank you.
With that, with the board, if the board has no questions for me, I just would like to put some testimony in from Mr. Soto.
All right.
Mr. Soto, I'm going to show you, and I believe the board has this. This is a settlement statement. The settlement statement is what it is, I guess, is the best way to put it. But can you tell the board what type of due diligence you performed when you or completed before you purchased this property in order to ascertain whether or not it was a one unit, two unit, etc.?
Well, I had spoken to the prior owners, and I had spoken to them about verifying that the property was a two unit, or it was legally a two unit, because I didn't want to run into these problems that we're having. They did get a hold of the tax department right here.
Well, let me take a look at that. So what we have here is an email from the tax department saying that
it is assessed and it's tax purposes, it is a two-unit apartment building.
I'm not sure if you have this email, but I can pass that around.
What's the day? I mean, the important thing is the date.
May 20th, 2016. It's a May 20th, 2016 email from the tax assessment. Now, admittedly, that's not zoning, and we understand that. That's why we're here looking for relief. What other steps did you take to ascertain or to confirm?
Well, we have copies of a prior inspection in 2015. Before I owned it, I purchased it in June, that verify that the inspector noted that physically the building was separated as two apartments with having two separate kitchens, two separate bathrooms, and inspected it as two separate apartments.
Okay, can you point out where specifically the board can find that?
Well, right here, it's highlighted. Apartment number one, first floor bathroom. apartment number one, floor kitchen, apartment number two,
there we go.
Bathroom, apartment number two, kitchen. So physically, it was always a two-unit apartment building.
Does the board have this?
No.
All right, I'll put that there for the board to, and that would be, I guess we were up to Mr. Knight,
six.
This would be six then?
Seven.
Seven. And the email would be seven, correct?
Whichever one.
Yeah. The email would be seven, and the, just for the record, it would be, it's a City of Reading Property Maintenance Division inspection report. This is dated 5/12/2015, the year prior to Mr. Soto's purchase.
My name's on there because it was sent to me, but I did not own it at the time.
You didn't own it on 5/20/2015.
As a point of clarification, all of the previous inspections by the Property Maintenance Division and zoning permits are in the board's packet, so okay. We have a history of that.
Oh, beautiful.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I can see going back to this date of inspection, 2/18/93. It indicated first floor unit, second floor unit. Rooms indicated with the, in that inspection. So that date indicates two.
We're going back to 93.
93.
Mr. Soto, can you explain to the board why you're here? How did you learn that there was a zoning issue with this property?
When I purchased the property, I got the packet welcoming me, and I filled out my paperwork to get the application for the proper zoning and licenses for the property. Sometime after that, I got a phone call stating that the property came up as a one unit. I spoke to the young lady on the phone and I was like startled. I said, what do you mean it's a one unit? You know, it's not a one unit. You know, I explained my situation. She said, well, I'm gonna look more into it. I'm gonna say about a month ago or 3 weeks ago is when I finally got the final call, and they said, listen, you know, everything that we looked into, it's coming up as a one unit apartment build or one unit. And you can't rent the two, you know, you're not going to be able to rent it as the two apartments. That's kind of when I said, well, you know, we need to try to make an appointment and try to see what's going on. And that's exactly when we got together and found out the issue with the zoning.
Up until then, did you have any idea that this building was zoned as anything other than a two-unit rental? I see here an appraisal report. Did you get this property appraised?
Yes.
Why did you get it appraised?
To acquire the funding needed to repair it and purchase it.
And what is the where from what source is the funding coming?
Community First Fund. It's a community or it's an organization that gets funds from the state and from local governments. And part of those things is I have to invest in like the City of Reading or Lancaster. I chose Reading.
You chose Reading because do you live here?
Yes, I do.
Do you own any other rental properties in the City of Reading?
Yes, I have three other apartment buildings and three single homes.
Are they all properly zoned as far as you understand?
I've never had a problem with zoning. All my properties are up to date with codes, zoning. Never had any issues.
At some point in looking at this, I guess you'll agree if I'm straight, at some point between 2013 and 2015, did someone use it as a single home?
That is what the information that we have gathered, and I said the prior owner is here. The situation that happened in 2013 was that the owner was living there by himself. He didn't choose to rent the other apartment anymore. He was at the time, I don't want to speak for him, but
yeah, if you'd like, I can bring him up or you can just
divulge, but I can give you what happened.
Okay.
He had spoken to, I guess, told he was getting two trash bills, and he said, hey, I don't want to pay two trash bills. I'm the only one living here. I'm no longer renting it. So from what I gather, he was told, well, if you fill out this paperwork, you only get one trash bill. Unknown to him, because till a couple weeks ago, he did not know that the paper that he signed was basically stating, or reverted it back to a single unit dwelling.
Wait, what Craig, I want you to, the wording here on this, because this is related to what you just said.
Sure.
I'm trying to get the dates and this respect to Mr. I see Mr. Rohrbach's. This is the paper. It's the zoning housing rental permit. It's a zoning permit. And the date on this paper that I'm looking is July of 2013. A codes review, and Craig, this word, property deconverted two units to one unit. What does that mean to us? What does that mean? It would be the word deconverted. I mean, I got an idea, but I want to make certain the legality of that term, if any.
Decrease.
But, all right, so.
Whenever there's a deconversion, it's just decreasing the total number of dwelling units. In this scenario, the previous owner submitted a zoning permit to decrease the building from two dwelling units to a single unit, and then subsequently made the overt act in terms of removing a meter to deconvert the property. Once those two items have taken place, it fits the definition of abandoning a non-conforming use in the MPC.
Now we're going back to, this is the next step, to go for two.
Now, what then happened was nothing else was changed. The units weren't combined, the kitchens weren't removed.
You still had
electric meters
to
were still in place.
Okay, so no overt.
No, there was an overt act. If there was no overt act, we wouldn't be. So the overt act did take place in terms of the deconversion. Therefore, we couldn't zone it back to two as a pre-existing non-conforming use. The current owner had to come before the board.
But the building remained physically the same, you're telling me.
Significantly the same.
Okay.
It's not 100%. But significantly.
Okay.
Substantially the same would be.
That's a better word.
Okay.
Yeah. Substantially the same.
All right. That's a key. All right.
I think you would find that somebody walking around that building today, if they'd grown up there 20 years ago, would say, this is the building I grew up in. This is, that's this room, that's that room. This is where the kitchen is. This is where the bathroom is, et cetera. Just for the record purposes, just to make sure we have a clear record, I'd like Mr. Rohrbach to go under oath.
Sure.
Yeah, can you come up here? I'm just simply going to ask him to confirm what
That's
Mr.
That's fine. She'll swear him in. He just gives his name and his address, and we'll go.
Would you raise your right hand, please? Yes. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help you God?
I do.
And your name?
Robert Rohrbach.
Do you spell it?
R-O-H-R-B-A-C-H.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Rohrbach. We met earlier. I'm Michael Mansour. I represent Mr. Soto. You were present in the room when Mr. Soto gave his testimony under oath as to the communications you had with Mr. Soto and what you represented to him that you had done prior to selling the property to Mr. Soto. Were you not sitting right over there?
Correct.
Did Mr. Soto accurately repeat or recite the communications that you had with him?
Correct.
And did you, I think the board member brought up the application, did you at some point, whether you remembered it or not, did you even remember having made that correction when you the deconversion when you sold it to Mr. Soto?
I just like it was spoken to the board here that my intentions were to, you know, get one trash bill. I was the only one living there, so part of my ignorance, I didn't realize that it deconverted.
So would it be fair to say that in your mind, even after you deconverted it as a matter of formal law, in your mind it was still a two-unit property?
Correct.
I don't have any further questions, if any of the board does.
Anybody here?
No, I'm fine.
You don't have a seat if you
Thank don't. You, thank you.
Thank you very much for that dispensation. Is it your intention, Mr. Soto, is it your intention, Mr. Soto, to rent this property for income?
Absolutely.
Do you service this property yourself? Will you be performing the maintenance yourself?
Yes.
When you took out the financing on the property, was the financing predicated on the ability to earn income from two units rather than one?
That's correct. The bill of sale that I submitted to the finance company, it's under a two-unit apartment building. That was the understanding that I was purchasing a two-unit apartment building.
So you made a representation on the loan application that you're purchasing a two-unit apartment building.
Absolutely.
Did part of that application, did you give any indication or did they require you to give any indication as to the number of people to whom you would be renting each apartment. Unit A and Unit B, there would be one person signing the lease for that one, and there'd be one person signing, and then there'll be people, either a single or it could be other people living with person A and other people living. Give me your vision of how many people you think would be living in those, a rough estimate.
Well, just to kind of back up a little bit, I'm very involved in my property, so I don't let people sublet, I don't rent rooms out, I don't let too many people in an apartment. I've already turned people down. I said, this apartment is way too small for the amount of people you're trying to put in there. So a three-unit apartment building, or I'm sorry, a three-bedroom upstairs, you have a maximum of two people in a room. Downstairs, depending on how they set it up, could be a one-bedroom or a two-bedroom. So I don't know if that answers your question, but I am very vigilant. I don't overcrowd my buildings or my apartments, and I don't permit that.
Well, just so you know, part of the crowding extends from the apartment down into the street. We are very aware of the parking situation here. Absolutely. Right? So that's why we ask these questions.
I have, like I said before, I have three other apartment buildings and three singles. I'm very involved in my properties. I'm at my properties, my wife would say, almost every day. She does say every day. I take great pride in my properties.
It's a good-looking property.
Yes. Well, yeah. That's after we painted it and fixed it. For that particular property, just gives you some insight of stuff that's already been done in there. All the plumbing was ripped out, replaced. Nothing was re-plumbed. It was just replaced. All the electrical panels have been replaced. The mechanicals, heating, all the windows have been, other than three, all the windows have been replaced in that apartment. The whole outside has been painted. Inside's been painted, new floors, all new fixtures. I take pride in my properties. And I always like to do things by the book. That's why at this situation, I was floored. My proper words was, I'm gonna have a panic attack. Because
You did have a panic attack.
I did have a panic attack. I like to do things right, and I'm here for the long haul. I've been here since 2000. I was born in Reading, came back in 2000, and my plans are to continue to purchase properties and make it back a good place. I do understand the parking situation, and I'm with you on that. I'm not trying to put an extra burden on the city. I'm on top of that stuff.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you.
Does any of the board have any other?
Anybody have any questions?
No.
Yeah, I think the situation you're in has come before us a number of times. That records don't always match and whatever. And, it's always tough because people think they bought one thing and they wound up with something else. And it's really nobody's fault. It's just one of those things that happen. So anybody here, any more questions?
To bootstrap on that, I can't stress enough how important it was to Mr. Soto to get this situation rectified the proper way as quickly as possible with you folks. He said that he had a panic attack. I'm not under oath, I'm an officer of the court. I can testify. He was at his wit's end when he found out about this situation, and he took appropriate, prompt, affirmative action in good faith to see if we could get this solved in a timely fashion, to both limit his financial burden, of course, which isn't your concern, and to see to it that this property is maintained at its highest, best use, which is.
Well, and we appreciate that, because I think getting things back on the right track in this city is important, and there's a lot of people that are trying to do that, and we appreciate when that happens. All right, is there anybody in the audience that has any questions of this applicant? Okay, well, I'll get to that in a minute, all right? Is there anybody who wants to testify against granting the application? Seeing none, anybody want to testify for granting the application? Okay, if you'd stand up and come on up.
Come on up, Mr. Rohrbach.
Got to go through this again, your name and your address, and she'll swear you in.
Sit in your reserved seat here.
We already swore you.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Okay, I didn't know.
I need you to keep your voice up for me.
Certainly.
Okay, go ahead.
Go ahead.
I sold the property to Nelson Soto, and I would just like to, you know, say on his behalf that he is a legitimate and respectful businessman with his other properties that he has in the area, and that's about it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very
your,
much.
Your address, do you have his address, Mr. Rohrbach's address?
I don't remember.
Okay. Do you want to give your address for the record, please?
My current address is 777 Hill Road. That's in Blandon, and the zip code is 19510.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
All right.
That was.
That's our copy.
That's his copy.
I thought that's what you.
Wait.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I don't know what's happening.
I'm sorry. I had some additional as far as the parking. The property is located catty corner from Bear Park, and so there's no residential units around a couple of blocks adjacent to the property. So there is quite a bit of parking. I just wanted to bring.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank
you.
Right.
Now,
you're asking about this. This legal. The reason I handed that up was he was asking about how many people would be staying in this apartment. Mr. Soto had taken the time to make a thumbnail sketch of the floor plan, and the issue seemed to resolve itself one way or the other before it got too involved. If it did get more involved, I was simply going to indicate to the gentleman that there was a floor plan there that he could take a look at. So obviously, I don't think to scale. You're a talented guy. But
I'm an architect. I was going to draw some stick figures in there, too.
But I just did that for the board's convenience.
I think
you think you have it there? Yeah. I just wanted to be sure. You know, these applications have so many pages in them, I always like to make sure that I have.
That's good. And our zoning officer does a good job of getting us information, but once in a while something gets missed or something shows up a little bit later. So
I always like to make sure that, I guess, you know, just as in closing, I would ask that the board view with favor the application for relief here so that Mr. Soto can begin the business of renting a refurbished rental property in downtown Reading to appropriate tenants with your admonition in the forefront of his mind.
All right. Well, we thank you, and that concludes this appeal. We'll make a decision at next month's meeting. You don't have to be here. It will be mailed to you, and we thank you for your presentation.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Madam Court Reporter, do you need this?
Okay, now we have some decisions to be rendered from last month's meeting. I was not present at the meeting, so I will not be voting on anything. So, Mr. Knight, I guess we'll let you take it from here.
Okay, we'll start with 118 South 9th Street. It was Appeal 30 of 2016. Is there a motion denying the relief requested per the conditions and findings set forth in the written decision?
Make a motion.
Second.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
Wait.
All in favor?
Yeah.
Aye.
Oh. All opposed? All right. The ayes have it. All right. The second one is 124 South 5th Street, Appeal 31 of 2016. Is there a motion approving the requested relief per the conditions and findings in the written decision?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Ayes have it. All right. Number three is 822 Binghamman Street, Appeal 32 of 2016. Is there a motion approving the requested relief per the conditions and findings set forth in the written decision?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Ayes have it. Number four is 126 North 5th Street, Appeal 33 of 2016. Is there a motion approving the requested relief per the conditions and findings set forth in the written decision?
My motion. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Ayes have it. All right, and the last one is 641 McKnight Street, Appeal 34 of 2016. Is there a motion approving the requested relief per the conditions and findings set forth in the written decision?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? All right, ayes have it.
Thank you. So that concludes our meeting for this month. We will meet again the second Wednesday of December. Whether you tune in or come in person, you're always welcome. One thing that I want to make clear is, if we give permission to do something, there are always a number of instructions to the applicant about things that they must follow. And it's very imperative that you follow them to the letter of the law. Not doing so has some pretty extensive economic consequences and legal consequences. We've been getting a lot more people coming before us and doing things the way they should. I think you've seen an example of that tonight, and that's very much appreciated. I think the city wants to work with people. We want to improve the city, but both parties have to do their part. So, you know, if you have received approval to do something, then please do it the way you've been instructed to. If you run into a problem, our zoning officer and the other people here are always willing to work with you and help you. It's better to ask somebody and talk to them first before going off on your own and then winding up with a bunch of problems. So other than that, I have nothing more to say, and we will see you in December. Thank you, everybody.